Man was made to worship. We were created to adore the transcendent. People worship and adore charismatic and talented people. Some people even worship the celestial bodies. Ladies and gentlemen, we have to get back to the heart of worship, to the true and living God.
The Heart of Worship Evangelistic Series with Pastor Nixon Lou.
Ladies and gentlemen, of course, we are out here night after night, and the topic for tonight is Breadfruit Tree Christianity. Please bow your heads with me as we pray. Holy God and Father, we ask you at this time to fill this place. Even the airwaves and the internet, oh God, may you set it aside so your name can be glorified. Even now, oh God, I pray for the individuals that need to hear that message, that, oh God, you will inspire them to stick to the channel and even get on the channel because, oh Father, this is an important message. I pray, oh God, that you would hide this preacher behind the shadow of your cross. And may your name be lifted up, we pray, in Jesus' name. Can somebody say amen and amen? Breadfruit Tree Christianity. Ladies and gentlemen, the British and French navigators introduced the breadfruit plant or tree, which is of a seedless variety, to the Caribbean islands in the late 1800s. The fruits are excellent source of nutrition, energy, and it is a protein-rich food. And in my studies to put this message together, I discovered, ladies and gentlemen, they used to feed the slaves back then breadfruit and saltfish. Hello? And for some people, they love breadfruit and saltfish. I'm a lover of breadfruit and saltfish. I got a couple of breadfruits sometime early this week. And let me tell you, they go on the port the next day. They give it to me in the night. Next day, it was in the port, in Jesus' name. It's good food. Good Caribbean food. Yeah. Yes, sir. Now, the tree grows easily, even with little care. You don't need to do nothing big for it to grow. You just put it in the ground and it grows. The trees are not affected by serious pests and disease problems. There are many dishes that you can make from the breadfruit fruit. the breadfruit. You could make breadfruit pie. Long time I haven't eaten breadfruit pie. He said, Lucia, they make that plenty. Yes, sir. And I heard there is what you call breadfruit lasagna. Now, I haven't eaten that one yet. You have breadfruit salad and breadfruit punch and breadfruit chips. Hello, somebody? I'm talking some good stuff here. And my last 9 years I spent in St. Vincent, I enjoy what we call roast breadfruit. Man, they just like roasting this thing. In St. Lucia, we like roasting it when it's ripe. But the Vincentian, they like roasting it green. And let me tell you, it tastes nice. Especially if you have a little jackfish with that. Nothing sweeter than that. And people from St. Vincent know what I'm speaking about. But some people like it steamed. Just put it in the pot and boil it up. And in St. Lucia, we like doing it like that. In Dominica, they do it like that too? All right, very nice. They do it like that here in Montserrat. Yes, sir. You pong it too. Yes, sir. In spite of all these benefits, the tree has a weakness. Is somebody here with the preacher? Due to the absence of seeds, the breadfruit tree has a kind of root system that grows from the plant itself. So when it is planted, the tree, the root grows from the plant. There is a name for it there. I don't want to tie my tongue. They say it's adventitious root system. Did I say that properly? The agriculturists that are here? We have some agriculturists and farmers in the place. Yes, sir. The roots can extend a considerable distance away from the tree, but they do not grow deeply in the soil. We have a property back in St. Vincent, and I was doing some cleanup sometime before I came here around the building, and I noticed there is a root in the place. I seen breadfruit tree. I said, where did breadfruit tree come from? We never throw nothing breadfruit outside there. And listen, the breadfruit tree, the root ran at least 200 feet. And listen, the property is on a hill, and the breadfruit tree is down in a hill. And the root climb up the hill and find itself next to the house. And ladies and gentlemen, because the breadfruit tree, the roots run horizontally, that makes it weak when it is faced with high winds. Is somebody here with the preacher? And I understood when you go past this place, hello, that almost every single breadfruit tree turned upside down. Because it has a weak root system. And not just that, when you have small winds, the branches break. It also have weak branches. Is somebody here with the preacher? Most Christians are like breadfruit trees. They have some use. They produce some kind of fruits in convenient weather. But when the storms of life comes, they are easily blown down. And some of them, they backslide. And some of them, they turn their backs on Jesus. Because they are not rooted and grounded and firmly in Jesus Christ. They are what I call breadfruit tree Christianity. You see, a breadfruit tree Christian is one whose faith fails when he or she is offended. But when I'm talking about breadfruit tree Christians, one whose faith fails when they encounter hypocrites and half-hearted Christians. I'm talking about breadfruit tree Christianity, one that is easily tempted, and when they fall, they stay in the mess. I'm talking about breadfruit tree Christianity. One who puts up a front and pretends in public, but in secret chambers, they indulge in vices and evil thoughts. I am speaking about breadfruit tree Christianity. One who is rough and crude, and they are unwilling for the grace of God to move them up and to lighten their tongue and put some positive thoughts in their head. They refuse to be molded by the grace of Jesus. I'm speaking about breadfruit tree Christianity. One that surrenders partially to Jesus while holding on to the things of the world and holding on to the ambitions of the world. I say they are breadfruit tree Christianity. Those who treat Christianity as a lifestyle, they just wear the thing like it is a clothing. And they take it off on another day. So they put on Christianity on a Saturday. They put on Christianity on a Sunday. But other days, they just and they are just normal. I'm talking about breakfast tree Christianity. One who has not given, and one who has not forgiven themselves, even though God has said to them, "My child, I have forgiven you." There are individuals that are carrying the past behind them because they have not forgiven themselves. And because of this, it weakens them spiritually. They feel that they are not to forgive others because they themselves were not forgiven. And I say, ladies and gentlemen, this is the attitude of a breadfruit tree Christian. As a result of breadfruit tree Christianity, many non-Christians are turned off by these individuals and think that Christianity is a joke. They also think that there are no real changes and there is no power to overcome sin, because when they see people who say they are Christians, that when the non-Christians look at themselves, they see that they are more moral than those that say that they are Christians. Lord Jesus, help me today. Consequently, many of these individuals think in becoming a Christian that they do not want to trespass there at all. There are many possible candidates, and they are turned off by breadfruit tree Christians. Tonight, what did I say, everybody? Tonight, many of you are concerned about your life, and you want to change, and some of you are considering becoming Christians again. Is somebody here? But you are fearful that you will be like those breadfruit tree Christians. Tonight, we will go to the Bible to discover how we can be rooted and grounded in Christ Jesus and be solid Christians. Can somebody say amen? Nathan, you didn't move the slides at all? You didn't see a breadfruit and a breadfruit tree when I was talking about breadfruit? Hello, somebody? Yes, sir. Now I'm ready for the words. Those were pictures. Yes, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, the first thing I want to say to us here about being rooted and grounded in Jesus is that for the Christian, he must live or she must live a life of faith. They must live a life of what, everybody? Yes, sir. You must have faith as a Christian. They have some individuals who come and just think that Christianity is just something on the side, and they do not want to trust the word of the living God. But the Bible says, who says, everybody? Yes, we put in one at a time. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6, reader, the Bible says, they're not hearing you, you know. It's on? Okay, go ahead.
But without faith, it is impossible to please him.
Yes, sir.
For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Fundamentally, to the Christian experience is having faith. In other words, when God says it, you believe it, and you move even though you don't see it. If God says to you, for example, God says to you, in fact, let me use a biblical illustration. God says to this man who was paralyzed for 38 years, Jesus says to him, "Hey, you take up your bed and walk." Hello? The man who have been in that place doesn't even know how to walk. He just heard the words of Jesus, and by hearing the word of Jesus, he just moved like he can walk, and praise the Lord, he was able to walk in Jesus' name.
The Bible continues to say, for as a Christian, in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 7, the Bible says,
for we walk by faith, not by sight.
We walk by faith and not by sight. I normally like using this illustration. If God puts a big a big 25-ton stone in front of you. There is a mountain in front of you. God says to you to push that stone. 25 tons. What do you do as a Christian? Do you say, Lord, I don't have a backhoe. Lord, I do not have the strength. Lord, I'm unable. If God says to push the stone, your responsibility is just push. God is responsible to move the stone. Many Christians, they want to see things before they move. In this world, everybody moves by sight. But ladies and gentlemen, for the Christian, we believe that we must trust the word of God, even though we don't see how things are going to work out. And this is the problem of Christianity in the 21st century. In fact, Jesus saw that, and Jesus says, when he comes in the earth, will he find faith? And because there is a lack of faith in this world today, we have lots of breadfruit tree Christianity. Lots of breadfruit tree Christians. So ladies and gentlemen, the first step is that you must have faith. You must have what, everybody? And secondly, put it, Nathan. Secondly, the second step in becoming a rooted and grounded Christian is that you must grow and you need repentance. You need what, everybody? Repentance is godly sorrow for sin. That is, being desperately sorry the way that you have lived your life contrary to God and contrary to the will of God and contrary to the law of God. You are sorry. You desire a new life. You desire change of life. You are fed up of the world. You fed up of the parties and fed up of the boyfriend and fed up of the girlfriend and fed up of the hangovers that you get with the bush rum. You fed up of the line and you fed up of the police always coming and knock on your door. You want a change of life. That is saying that you want to make a way right with God. You want a new heart. You want pardon. You want repentance. And ladies and gentlemen, that is when God is speaking to you as an individual. If you feel that way, it is God that is speaking to you. If you feel this way, it is God that is speaking to you. He is leading you and guiding you to repentance. And let me say something here. You cannot on yourself decide to repent at the time that you choose to repent. For the Bible says in Romans chapter 2 and verse 4, the Bible says,
or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance?
It is the goodness of God that leads you to repentance. Some people believe they could repent when they want. They could turn to God when they want. But ladies and gentlemen, it is God that is creating the scenario in your life. It is God that is protecting you. And his goodness is upon you. That is why, my ladies and gentlemen who are listening to me, that you go and lead to repentance. It is the goodness of God. You were sick on the hospital bed. And the doctors gave up on you. But the Lord says, I need to lead that boy. I need to lead that girl, that woman, that man. I need to lead them to repentance. And for some miracle, you get out of the hospital. I know many persons who, when they went to the hospital, the doctors would have said to them, hey, that is it. Probably went to a party. I'm speaking to you here, those of you who are listening online. You went to the party and somebody had an intention to take your life. You got in a scrabble, you got in a fight, and ladies and gentlemen, you have that knife came to stab you. But praise the Lord stayed the hands. I was doing a crusade in my first district supervising. Had this crusade, baptized two young ladies. And before I baptized them, they had a squabble at school. And one of them had a knife, unknown to the other. And ladies and gentlemen, they found themselves in that squabble. And this bad girl, she take up the knife and she going to stab the other one. But for some reason, the Lord stayed her hands and she could not put the hands down. Let me tell you something. Many of us, the Lord protects us from accidents and danger. Why? Because he wants you to come to repentance. The enemy wants to take your life, but the Lord wants to bring you to repentance. Oh, help me, Lord Jesus, tonight. When you have this desire to repent, it is God speaking to you. If you respond by saying, one day I will give my heart over to Christ, I say it is a foolish thing for you to do as an individual. Because it is God that is working out things for you. You do not know what day you will wake up. You do not know if you will wake up in the morning. You know, some people plan their Christianity. Yes. They say, okay, well, I need to get a job first. I need to get a wife, a husband first, you know. You know, they want to have a child first. They want to set up their career first. And they say, okay, then I will accept. Ladies and gentlemen, when the thing is fresh with you, and I'm speaking to you tonight over the internet, if the Lord says to you, hey, it's time to come back to me, it is God that is speaking to your heart. That's why the Bible says, in Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13. The Bible says, reader.
For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure.
It's God that's working. It's God that is leading. Every step you take, every breath that you make, you might make your plan, but God plans supersede your plans to lead you into the path of repentance. And he that works out in you both to will and to do his good pleasures. To will, put the thing, Nathan, to will, that is wanting to do right. God gives you the desire to want to do right and to do. The willingness, one, to do right, and put the other one, and the power to do right. Can somebody say amen? It is God who leads us and helps us to do right. All we have to do is to surrender our lives. All what we got to do is to follow and cooperate with God. Can somebody say amen? The Bible says in John chapter 6 and verse 14. Sorry. John chapter 6 and verse 44, the Bible says, reader.
No man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is re-emphasizing the point here tonight that God is the one that calls his sons and his daughters. And if he's calling you tonight, do not turn your backs on him. If an appeal is made tonight and you get the impression to surrender your heart to Jesus, it is God drawing you. It is not the preacher. It is God's loving voice that you are hearing, saying, my child, it's time to come back home. It's time to come to the hands of the God that loves you. And ladies and gentlemen, that is what repentance leads to. There is one benefit of repentance I want to make known. According to Acts chapter 3 and verse 19, the Bible says,
repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord.
Can somebody say amen? When you get repentance, your sins are blotted out. I say praise God. No one wants to live their life with sin hanging on their lives. They do not want sin to be in their life, because anytime your number could call up. And if you have sin in your life when you die, ladies and gentlemen, that means you are lost case. That's why every single day we must go to the cross of Jesus, so the blood of Jesus can be applied to our lives where we find repentance. In order to be rooted and grounded in Christ, and for us to walk confidently as a Christian, we need to confess and forsake. We need to do what, everybody? Confess and forsake. That is telling God of your sinful condition. That is telling God of your wrongs and of your sins. Now, somebody says that, hey, why do you have to tell God? God knows already. But let me tell you something, that when you come to the presence of the Lord and you humble yourself and you tell him and you confess your wrongs, it does something to you as an individual. They say confession is what? Confession is what? Confession is good for the soul. Nathan, put the thing. Acknowledging your lost condition. You know, they have some people, they live in the worst kind of life and they think they're making it to heaven. Hello, somebody? Once you speak to them, I don't know where they get the impression they could live anyhow and make it to the kingdom. Hello? I don't understand that. I met a guy at one time when I just started my ministry. Met the guy by the rum shop. Man drunk like a fish, Elder Barnes. Drunk like a fish. And you see, we are passing, giving out handbills for a crusade that we were having. And the man started getting on. Yeah. Yes, Pastor, I'm making it to heaven too, you know. And he showed me a bottle of SLR. That's one of the hot rums, it said Benson. And he said, Pastor, this bottle will be up there with me too. And he's saying, I'm going to make it to heaven and Reverend will have rum. Ladies and gentlemen, people are twisted and think they could live anyhow and make it to the kingdom. But ladies and gentlemen, we must come, when we come to Jesus, we must tell him of our wrongs. Can somebody say amen? Acknowledge that you are lost. You speak it to people and say, oh, Pastor, everything all right. I'm on the heaven-bound train. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, nobody could doubt you. But sometimes when you're wrong, you have to just acknowledge your condition. Put it again, Nathan. We must confess our sinful acts to God. And if we have hurt or injured anyone, we should confess to them also. Hello, somebody. And there are times we need to make restitution. Zacchaeus, when he thief from people, when he repented and he became a Christian, not a breakfast tree Christian, when he became a real Christian, he restored unto the people that he stole from. There are sometimes you have to go and ask people forgiveness for what you have done to them in the past and what you have said to them in the past. Because ladies and gentlemen, when you hurt somebody, you are actually hurting God who created that individual. Any wrong act done to any human being is like being done unto God. And you have to go to the person and ask for forgiveness. You have to let them know, I did that. Or if you are someone that's working a place and you steal some money, you have to return the money. That is what the grace of God does to you. When you see you are melted, you are able to give back what you have stolen in the past. And some people believe they just have to come baptized and that's it. But ladies and gentlemen, for true conversion to take place, you need to come and you need to say what you have done wrong. And that's why sometimes on the last Sabbath afternoon, we normally give people an opportunity for them to testify. Hello? And I always testify when I preach. How I used to be, what I used to do. I try not to go in details. Because you wonder, boy, pastor, boy, you do some of those things? Hello? We have to make restitutions. And people we have injured, we have to go to them. Can somebody say amen? The Bible says in, come on, put the text. In James chapter 5 and verse 16, what does the Bible say? Confess our what?
Faults.
One to another and do what? Pray for one another that you may be what?
Healed.
Let me tell you. The greatest joy a Christian can have when he has come out of sin is somebody that they have done wrong. And they go to the person and confess. I have seen it happen. There were a couple of guys, my friends. They were not on the best terms. They were there as a group, reading and praying together, but they were divided. And sometimes we are like that in the church. We in the church, we sit down there, we praise God, and we sing the song. We are marching to Zion. Which Zion? Conflict in the camp. But the Holy Ghost touched one of them. Hello? And I could remember that night. It was a Friday night. We were doing our prayers. A Friday night. Up on a hill. And the brother said to the other brother, my brother, I did wrong against you. Please forgive me. I am sorry. I have never seen joy and peace so much that when people forgive one another, the Bible says that there is healing. Sometimes the church needs to heal. Sometimes we need to confess our faults that we have done to one another so that the Lord can bless us. Sometimes this condition ties the church. The church is under a darkness because individuals there, they march into Zion and they have hurt one to another and they will not confess. Breadfruit tree Christianity. Father, please help me. Please help me here, Lord, today. Jesus says, put the thing. Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 13. He says what? He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whosoever do what? And do what?
And forsaketh them shall have mercy.
I say praise be to the living God. You not only to confess your faults, you have to turn away from them. You have to forsake them. If the Lord forgive you from fornication, you're not supposed to go back in the thing. Is somebody listening to me? You confess, say, Lord, I have been womanizing, running around the place. Hello? You say, Lord, I have been drinking the SLR and the Red Sparrow and the Bush Ram and the Heineken Bears and all the Peter Bears and all these kind of bears. And you confess to the Lord, say, Lord, please forgive me. Amen. And next week you don't buy the bar. You don't buy the sister home. Midnight. You take your car tinted black and you go in the bush down by the river or down by the beach. Jesus says that when you confess, you must forsake. Somebody need to hear this message here today. The Bible says that there is a reason why the Lord wants us to confess. Put the thing, Nathan. The Bible says that if we confess our sins, hallelujah. He's what, my sister?
Faithful and
just. He's what?
To forgive us our sins.
Hallelujah.
And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Because his faithfulness, you could come to him boldly. And when you see, you confess and you tell people that you're sorry, they don't have to forgive you for you to feel well about yourself. When you go to God, he's faithful and just to forgive you of all your sins. Amen. cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I say, if you want to be a true Christian in heart, if you want to grow in your Christian experience, and you want to have a level of righteousness, you have to confess your sins to God. And there is a reason for that. I say there is a reason for that. Put the thing, Nathan. In Psalms chapter 34 and verse 18, the Bible says,
the Lord is nigh unto them.
The Lord is where, everybody?
Nigh unto them.
Unto who?
That are of a broken heart.
Broken heart, yes, sir.
And saveth such as be of a contrite spirit.
Let me say something here. You see, when you come to God as a broken spirit, this is what the Lord wants. Hello, somebody. God wants you to humble yourself and come to Him. The Lord, ladies and gentlemen, wants you to give yourself to Him in humility. He also wants you to come to Him and for you to say, Lord, I have sinned against you. I have broken your laws. I am prepared to do what you tell me to do. And when you do that, guess what? The Bible says in Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28 to 30, the Bible says,
come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me.
Yes, sir.
For I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls.
The Bible says in verse 30, the Bible says, come on, put the thing. There's not no 30. Jesus says, come unto me, all ye that what? Labor and are what? Heavy laden. I will give you rest. Let me say something here. There are a lot of people that are heavy laden. Hello? You all have issues dealing with it, raising your pressure. Hello? You have things thinking about that, problems you have, people. It gets you depressed. It makes your heart palpitate. It makes it beat fast when you see the person. But Jesus says, hallelujah, come on, take that burden and lay it upon Jesus. And if you notice, I try to get this thing, you know, the yoke.
My burden is light.
The yoke is easy and his burden is light. Because you see, the big cow, hello, carries the weight for the small cow. Hallelujah. Come on, you need to follow the preacher here. Jesus is the big cow. Hello? You need two cows for them to till the soil, but if the big cow carries the load, the load for the small cow is reduced. That's why Jesus says to take my yoke. I am the one that is helping you. I am the one that is leading you. I will give you the emotional strength. I will give you the spiritual strength. Even though you don't know how to say, I am sorry. Even though you do not how to know how to say, please forgive me. The Lord will give you the strength. The thing is that people do not want to lay the burdens on Jesus. They want to carry it on their own. And they are traveling a heavy burden. They are walking the road and they have burdens upon their shoulders. In order to get peace and joy, put the thing, Nathan, I think that's it now. In order to get peace and joy, you have to believe that you are forgiven. Hello, somebody. Trust God. God cannot lie. If God says to confess your faults and he says to confess your sins, he is able to forgive you. Why do you have to keep on carrying that load behind you? People want God to forgive them, but they will not forgive themselves. Trust God, he cannot lie. What he says he will do, he will do. Trust God, ladies and gentlemen, and say like Paul, put the thing, Nathan, put the thing. The Bible says in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 13, the Bible says,
brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended.
Yes, sir.
But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before,
Ladies and gentlemen,
we need to put our past behind us because the Lord has a future in store for us. Forgetting those things are behind, and we need to reach for those things that are before, which is eternal life in Christ Jesus. Amen. When you go through repentance, put that in. When you go through repentance and confession and you forsake your sins, you become a converted Christian. You become, ladies and gentlemen, you become a born-again Christian. Christ imputes, or he credits you his righteousness, and this is what we call grace. Hello, somebody? He imputes his righteousness on you. So when God looks at you, he doesn't see you. He sees Christ's life through you, in you. Christ takes away your life of sin and gives you a life of righteousness, and your name is written in heaven. Hallelujah. Woo! Sign my name. Hallelujah. With a golden pen. I don't know about you, but I have that conviction in my heart that Nixon Lewis's name is written in the books of heaven. People live in their life like the names are not written up there. They are not citizens of the kingdom. But ladies and gentlemen, if God says he forgives me, I am forgiven. And therefore, ladies and gentlemen, I could walk the streets of Braves. Come on, put the text, Nathan. I could walk the streets of Lookout. I could walk the streets of Woodlands, because the Bible says,
now, no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit.
There is therefore now no condemnation. Point your finger as you want. Nixon used to be this and Nixon used to be that, but praise be to the living God. The Lord has convinced me. He has put within me this assurance that he has forgiven me, and I could walk the streets and know that I am forgiven. That's what it means to be a Christian. The assurance of forgiveness. But if you don't forgive others, you cannot claim that forgiveness. No condemnation. Hallelujah. Oh, praise be to the Lord. The Bible says that there is therefore no condemnation. But you will make mistakes after you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. Hello? Yes. Like a baby beginning to walk, you will stumble and sometimes fall. But that's okay. The song says, he's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. It took him a week to make the moon and the stars, the sun and the earth and Jupiter and Mars. But I am so special. He takes his time to work on me. And let me tell you, sometimes if you see I'm going wrong, it will not hurt if you come and say, Pastor, I heard you say that. That does not sound right. Hello, somebody. I saw you down there, and Pastor, that don't look right. That is what we do as Christians. We help one another along the road. Amen. Don't go behind pastor back and lambast pastor. Is somebody listening to me? We have to learn, ladies and gentlemen, to help one another out on that road to heaven. And this is what Christianity is about. Christianity is not just looking at the fault in others, but because we're on the same road, we help one another out. Because one day you would slip and you will need someone to say, hey, come on, my sister, pick up yourself. Come on, my brother, pick up yourself. The song says, and I learned it as a Catholic a long time ago, if you see your brother standing by the road with a heavy load from the seed he sowed, and if you see your sister standing by the way, just stop and say, we're going the wrong way. I learned that as a Catholic boy. But we don't practice this as Seventh-day Adventists. We have to learn to talk to one another. And let me tell you, people might feel bad when you come and tell them something. But once you open the Bible and say, oh, that's what the Bible says, you do it in fear and humbleness.
You don't want to big up yourself and push up your chest and say you're wrong and you're wrong and you're wrong. Hello, somebody. I am talking about practical Christianity. And this is what makes a true Christian. People are looking for all kinds of theology and know everything about the end time and know everything about prophecy. But this is basic Christianity. Once you get that, you get it right. You could know everything about the church. You could know everything about the theology of the Seventh-day Adventist church. You could know everything about the Bible, and you don't practice those basic little things. You ain't ready yet. Breakfast tree. Christianity. A Christian is always in need of grace. Nathan, I think I have it there right now. A Christian always need of grace. We sometimes normally talk of grace when people come to Christ. But let me tell you, every single morning you wake up, you need the grace of the living God to be on your life. Because his breath that he puts in your nostril is grace. His mercies are renewed every single day. Put the thing, to become a Christian, you need grace. And to remain a Christian, come on, Nathan, you need grace. Because you cannot do it on your own. I say you need grace. This is because there is a possibility that you fall away and backslide. Hello? They have some people that talk about once save, always save. Hello? The Bible says in 2 Peter chapter 17, chapter 3, verses 17 and 18, the Bible says,
therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness.
Fall away from your what? Own steadfastness. That means you were rooted and grounded. Hello? That you were steadfast. But there is a possibility, Peter says, that you can fall away from your steadfastness. And what does he say in verse 18? Put the thing, Nathan. Verse 18 is there. The Bible says,
but grow in grace.
Yes, sir.
And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and forever. Amen.
You need to grow in grace. You know, we talk about grace and we sing about grace, but God wants us to have grace every single day in our lives. Because we'll always stumble and fall. Even big people that are grown, hard-back people, they fall. Yes. Some people fall, they bruise their hip, they bruise their ribs, they bruise their head, they break something. Even big people still fall. But Jesus says that we must grow in grace and in the knowledge. Man, you must understand this. You must understand that when you become a Christian, God do not want you to stay the same place that he meets you. He wants you to go onto that perfect day where that light grows brighter and brighter. So the Bible, hello somebody, has to be by your side. There must be development and change like a baby who is growing and developing. Learn to walk, then run. It takes time. It's not an overnight thing. Grow in favor with God. Depend upon God. People must see God working in your life. Your neighbor must see. Hello? Your neighbor must see. Your co-worker must know that this is not the same person that they used to know before. Hello, somebody? Yes. I could remember. I think I've said this here before already, you know, but I'm going to say it again. Remember Lyman, when I was a wayward man, Lyman had, in the back of my car, had a cooler. I used to be the shipping and operations supervisor for the boats that come in down on the port in Viewfort. When you see I bought that boat, the guys give me cases of beers, Milwaukee Buck. Hello, somebody? Beck's, the best of German beer. Giving me all the good rum, like Johnny Walker Black and Jack Daniel and Courvoisier, all the big things. And when you see we moving on Friday night, every man have the vehicle, but I carry the cooler because I have the drinks. Hello? And behind the cooler, all the drinks in there. When a lineman coming back late on Saturday. Wayward boy! Like a prodigal son. Not like a prodigal son, a prodigal son. But when I decided to come over to Jesus, I had to stop the lineman with the boys. Hello? Yes. When the captain gave me the best, I had to say, no, sorry. In fact, I had to adopt a trick. Go up and said to the captain, when I go up with customs and immigration, when I go up there with them, I would say, okay, Cap, we have finished the documents. The guys are staying there with you. I'm coming in shortly. He will not see me until the ship ready to go. Hello? But one day he jammed me. One day he jammed me. He jammed me real good. But ladies and gentlemen, on that, after I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior, I had to put away those things. So one Friday, I come in from work, all happy, coming from the office, going to my car. This guy blocked me. Say, you, what have you done to our friend Nixon? We used to lie on Friday nights and drink our beers. Where is that Nixon? Dead man. Hello, somebody. He's a dead man. God do not want you to remain the same place that he found you. He wants you to grow and develop. Is somebody here with me? People have to see change in your life. And ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, we need to study the Bible and pray to God. Develop a relationship with God. Speak to him every day. Now in my family, very early in the children's life, I have had them not to depend on family worship. And that is a fault many Seventh-day Adventist Christians do. Come out for worship, children. Come out for worship, children. And the children, all what they know is corporate worship. They do not know personal relationship with God. So very early, you take up your Bible and do your devotion. Speak to God in prayer and let God speak to you in his word. You must spend time meditating on the word of the Lord. You must have a relationship with God. And that is able, you are able to do that as an individual every single day. You need to spend time with God. But some people just jump up and run out of the house because they have to go to work. Work more important than God. If you got to work early, get up early. Is somebody here with me? When you discover the will of God, you do not hesitate to follow the will of God. Read your Bible, pray every day, and you will what? Grow, grow, grow. You become a Christian by accepting Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you follow his truth. Can somebody say amen? You remain a Christian depending totally on Christ to keep you. For the Bible says, Nathan, the Bible says, come on, put the text. In Jude chapter 1 and verse 24, the Bible says,
now unto him that is able to keep you from falling.
He's able to keep you.
And to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy.
I say praise the Lord. Amen. God is able to keep you. Let me tell you something, people. You think, Pastor, that you think he's all that? I have had my struggles. You think it's easy being a Christian? Sometimes you have demons in your life that you have to deal with. They have habits that you have cultivated over the years. The Lord have to take that from you. It's not an overnight thing. Sometimes your parents have handed over to you predispositions to sin. Given you in your DNA, pass on habits to you. Some people, they have children and they drink rum, and the children from very early, they start drinking rum, and sometimes they have to get out of that. Only God can get you out of that. But I love this text. The Bible says God can keep you. Hallelujah! Let nobody fool you and say you accept Christ. I give you 5 days. I give you 5 months. I could remember in this crusade that we were preaching that this guy accepted, a notorious guy in the community. And the man, his tongue just bad. The man go a carnival. The man do all kinds of things. And we have this fellowship one Sabbath afternoon. And this woman sat on the step of somebody's house. And she stood up and said, hey, you, I give you 2 weeks. When carnival come, I will remind you that you have accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior and that you will turn back. But praise the Lord, God is able to keep us. Matthew, put it. Shutter boy, always like a party. Always like keeping a fete, and he kept a fete for Jesus. Although he was a party goer, the Lord called him, and the Lord was able to keep him. Put it. Mary Magdalene, the prostitute that was giving herself everybody. Hallelujah. The Lord is able to keep. Also Zacchaeus, put that thing. Thief. Robber. White color, blue color, yellow color, all kind of green color. Criminal. But the Lord saved Zacchaeus. Peter, the backslider. Hello, somebody. You think Peter wasn't a backslider? In church, but lost. Denied Christ with cursings and swearing that if you would hear that come from a Christian mouth, you would say, hey, this man is not a Christian. And that's how he was able to convince the people around him that he was not a servant of Christ, because of the tongue, the words. But praise the Lord was able to accept him back. And God is able to give us a new heart. Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse 26, the Bible says what?
A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh.
Can somebody say amen? God is able to change us. He has the power, and he's able to. Cast your burdens on Jesus. Cast your burdens on who, everybody? Cast your burden on Jesus. Come on, Nathan. Cast your burden on Jesus. For the Bible says in Psalm 55 and verse 22, the Bible says,
cast thy burden upon the Lord.
Do what, everybody?
Cast thy burden upon the Lord.
Yes, sir.
And he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved.
Amen. That's the promises of the Lord. I say that's the promises of the Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, the blood of Jesus is able to cleanse us. Don't matter what you have done in your past. If you confess your sins, you repent of your sins, you say to Jesus, Lord, I accept you as my Lord and Savior. And you say, Lord, please forgive me. The Lord will cleanse you and grant you forgiveness. And the Lord will be able to change your life. As you listen to this song, I pray that you will be drawn closer to the Lord tonight.
Of suffering brought me healing. He spilled his blood to fill my soul. His crown of thorns made me royalty.
waiting for you to turn over to him. He wants to give you peace. He wants to carry your burden. Will you say to Jesus today, I accept you as my Lord and Savior. I want repentance. Lord, save me tonight. If that is your desire, I invite you at this time to bow your heads with me, wherever you are, in front of your television, in front of your computer, in front of your phone. Just bow your heads with me as we pray. Holy God, thank you for salvation, full and free. Lord, there's none of us good. And that's why you came to save sinners. You have died on the cross for us, and you are offering salvation, forgiveness. But Lord, that forgiveness will be nothing if we just say, Lord, I believe. But Lord, you want us to go from more than believing. You want us to take action. You want us to repent. You want us to confess our sins. You want us, O Father, to come to you and forsake our sins. And you said, O God, you will accept us as your children. Father God, please accept us today. And those who are listening, we ask you, dear Father, to minister to them, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. If this message have touched you, I want you to go straight to the website. Go straight to the website and answer the question. Answer the question that are out there for the decision to accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. Not just accept Christ as your Lord and Savior. We are asking you, even you could call for prayers. Call for prayers and go to the website and ask for prayers. Man was made to worship. We were created to adore the transcendent. People worship and adore charismatic and talented people. Some people even worship the celestial bodies. Ladies and gentlemen, we have to get back to the heart of worship, to the true and living God.
The Heart of Worship Evangelistic Series with Pastor Nixon Lou.